I'm Adam Gibbons. I record under the name Lack of Afro. And this is how I do things. Motown was a massive part of my childhood growing up. My dad was a soul music collector. And music was always playing around the house. A lot of it was soul music. If you're a person who likes soul, funk, disco, combined with, you know, sort of later genres like hip hop, then I think you'll maybe get something out of my music. I've got so much love to give. I've got so much love to give, baby. Now what do you say? Why don't we spend a while on it? DJ Shadow was a big influence early on. Introducing. And that was when I was into sampling a lot more. Yeah, that album was kind of changed everything really for me when I heard that.
And these guys are the masters at it.
To think it was one guy on his own doing all that stuff was incredible. Just him and a stack of records basically blew my mind, to be honest. I always wanted to be a record producer, as in like a George Martin, Beatles, get a band in a studio, produce a record, that kind of thing. I had no designs to be an artist. I had no designs to just work on my own. I didn't think you could do that.
And these guys are the masters at it.
It didn't even occur to me. It was only when I heard DJ Shadow and Moby also with Play, and the fact that you could be one guy, just be one guy and do all that stuff. And that opened my eyes to actually what could be achieved.
Y'all ready for this? Hey, y'all ready, fellas?
In the early days, I used to sample a lot. For me, it kind of gave me so much scope, and it enabled me as one guy to create these full soundtracks that sounded like it was a band. As the years have gone on, I've sampled less and less. Instead, I've just replaced the samples with real instruments now. I'm lucky enough to have a studio where I can call on musicians to come in and record. Such a way in keeping that 60s and 70s aesthetic and sound and feel, and then adding my bit as I always used to do.
Yes, mate, great stuff.
In my studio, I've got a mixture of analog and digital equipment. Working digitally as well as analog, it kind of gives you the best of both worlds, I think. I find the sound of analog equipment is still superior to digital for what I need to make. You record all through this lovely warm analog signal chain, then it's in the computer, then you can literally edit it. And that's what I love about digital, is the ease of working with it when it's all in the computer, all in the box. You can then edit, you can chop, manipulate, move, make something new out of something else. No, that's when digital kind of comes into its own. In the traditional way, I use microphones. I use microphones to record instruments. All the instruments that I record go into this mixing desk. It's a 12-channel Alice 1228 mixing desk from the 70s. They're originally broadcast desks, I think, for radio and stuff, but they are the most underrated desk that I've ever heard. It just does the job so well. It's so warm, it's so punchy. It naturally compresses everything that goes through it. Just using three mics on the kit these days. So I've got a snare mic, a kick mic, and a mic in a kind of funny position just to the right of the snare. And that's a Coles mic. That's a Coles ribbon microphone. They're designed by the BBC way back. And it just sounds lovely. And those three mics going through the mixing desk and kind of naturally compressing is kind of giving the sound that I'm after at the moment. the sound of all the records that I love. If I was digging for drum samples and I came across a little break that sounded like the drums that I've got now in my studio, I would sample them in a heartbeat. So I consider it a box ticked that I've now got a drum kit that sounds like a sample break. Every album I've made on a different sequencer. What I'm using these days is Ableton. It's great for editing audio. That's where it's brilliant, I think. You can edit audio so quickly and move things around and that kind of thing. Changing sequences for every album forces you to relearn a sequencer, which then forces you to look at your process more. I've had a different studio setup for every album I've done, which I think has clearly played a part in how the albums sound. But it's also kept me on my toes, I think, also. You know, you're constantly looking at, you know, what you need pieces of equipment for, what do they do? Do you actually need it? And if not, then you get rid of it and get something else for the next record. I say all this, but who knows what the future holds? You know, I don't know. I take it album by album. I might change the entire process for the next one, get new gear in, get some new instruments, some new stuff's happening. I don't know, who knows? What I do know is that I love making music and I feel like I've got a lot left to say, so who knows?
Yeah, man.
I've always been about the drums, really. If you recorded a funk track, for example, and you had a live kit and it was mic'd up in a raw way, like a couple of mics on the kit or whatnot, or one mic on the kit in some cases, then it's going to sound like a funk track. If you then replace those drums with 80s drums, for example, with a massive snare, huge reverb, Phil Collins sound, it's not going to sound like a funk track anymore. All the rest of the instruments could have every other instrument on there being the same instrument, but replace the drums and the track is just totally different. If I'm in the studio myself, I'll either jump on the drum kit and lay down like a temporary drum track, which very often becomes the actual drum track. I can hear the drum sound in my head fairly quickly. The sort of track that you want to write will dictate the drum sound, and vice versa. So if you want to write a soul track, then you kind of know what the drums are going to sound like, because you know what soul music is. The drums, they're a reconditioned 1950s Premier kit. I basically found this drum kit in a cupboard in the studio complex in Brighton, and robbed the studio and it was kind enough to say, you can keep it if you can do it up. So I basically took the drums and reconditioned them and, you know, polished all the chrome up and removed all the rust and reskinned them. And it just sounds great. Especially the floor tom is my favourite. It just sounds amazing. With added tea towels. The tea towels provide the dampness, the kind of the dryness.
Yeah, nice, mate. You're done.
Go. Percussion is a big thing for me. It never was, but it's turned into this huge deal. I remember the first album that I did, there was a few tambourine parts that I played over that I recorded, and that was fine. But now I'm all about percussion. I think little use of different percussion on different sections of a song can really enhance it. Like, tambourine is the most underrated instrument, I think. And I've got stuff like here, I've got a cowbell and a güiro and a cabasa and shakers, chime bells, all these things. You add these things into songs, like you use them wisely, and they just, in conga drum and bongos, and they just, you know, glockenspiel is an amazing tool too. They just add so much, and they provide that kind of, that human element as well. Saxophone was my kind of primary instrument for a long time when I was 12. That's the instrument that I did lots of grades in and kind of, you know, got fairly high up. But then I learned classical saxophone. This was before the jazz grades came in. So consequently, when I went to university and got asked to improvise in a group situation, I couldn't do it. I had to go back and relearn jazz saxophone, basically, and how to improvise. You know, I'm learning still with the saxophone, really. But that's exactly why I get musicians in who can play, you know, proper horn players, you know, not like me. Bass guitar is one of my favourite instruments, and it's one of the instruments that I pick up now. It's what I play in the Lack of Afro live band, mostly. This one is a reproduction of a 1961 Fender Shell Pink jazz bass, and it's great. 12-string guitar, which is great for bringing in and out of choruses. It's like a tuned percussion, almost. You get that shimmery 12-string kind of floaty thing that you can bring in and out of choruses. Cool. Just to lift it, helps kind of lift the chorus. My Aria acoustic guitar here, the Blue Chap, that's the first guitar I ever owned, and it sounds horrible, but it's got sentimental value, so he stays. This little chap here, this is a Jetson guitar from the 60s, like a Telecaster copy. Really crunchy, lo-fi sound. Very suitable for some things, really unsuitable for others, but it does a job. This is a Roland Double Beat Fuzz Wah pedal, and it's got the most incredible fuzz on it. The wah-wah is awful, sounds weedy. Never use the wah-wah, but the fuzz, it's got three types of waveform you can use, and it's just, there's no mix knob, so it's either full on or nothing, but it sounds amazing, love it. It's all over the Back in Business EP, and it'll all be all over the next album for sure. This is a Mark I Fender Rhodes piano. Fender Rhodes piano is on so many records. It's just one of those sounds that you hear and you instantly know. Each one sounds different as well. This one is a particularly nice sounding example. It doesn't look the best, but it sounds amazing. And it's just the sound of so many records. It's the most flexible thing too. You can drive it through an amp, you can put it through various effects, you can make it, you know, dirtier. And it just seems to work. It's just one of those sounds, really. If you've got access to the real thing, like a real piano, a real Fender Rhodes, a real Hammond, then, you know, you just can't be the real thing. Simple as that. Juno 6. I was recording in Brooklyn with Herbal Tea. They had a Juno there, and I played it for a track we were doing. I just fell in love with it. I just love the fact that everything's there in front of you. There's no presets, fully analog. I have to take photos of this. Like when I come across a really nice sound on it, I have to take a photo of it, otherwise I forget. There's no recall, there's no storage, there's nothing. Not even MIDI on this, nothing. But I love it for that, because what you see is what you get. This is it, it's what you hear, it's the sound of analog completely. Although I did find out later that the one I played in Brooklyn wasn't actually this one, it was a Juno 60, so I bought the wrong synth, but you know, this one still sounds nice. The piano that I use is my gran's piano. It's actually the piano that I learned on. When I was 7 years old, I started learning piano. She started teaching me. She was a pianist, an amazing pianist. And it's been in my mum and dad's house for years. Then they moved and it had to go into storage, and now I'm lucky enough that I've got it here. It's been reconditioned. It's over 100 years old, but sounds incredible. And finally I can record with it, and it's just lovely to have it here. It just feels like there's a, you know, member of the family here. Yeah, she's long since passed, but feels like she's kind of here, you know, being part of the music. I get frustrated quite often. I'm my own worst enemy. When you're doing this for a job, you think the pressure is on. Obviously the pressure is there to make money from doing what you love to do. It's great because you're doing what you love to do for a living, but conversely, the pressure is ramped right up because you then think, right, I've got to make money from this somehow. And it goes against every fabric, every you as a musician. Why you make music in the first instance is because you love music. You're drawn to it and it makes you happy. But then when you're doing it for a living, you feel the pressure so much more and you think, right, okay, so how about this? Is this gonna, maybe this, people might like this? And you start thinking what people might like, what they might buy. Because you have to, because you have to put food on the table. But when you actually first pick up music, you're doing it for the sheer love of it. And that, you've got to be so careful when you're doing it for a living, or when you're an actual working producer, musician, that you're not just going through the motions, because that comes across in your music. So you have to just try and relax a bit and just try and let stuff come rather than trying to force it. When you start forcing stuff, it just doesn't happen. For every album I do, I try and get better. I try and make a better album every time. When you're a new artist, you just have to get an album out there and make your mark, and that starts the process. But when you're kind of six albums in, like I'm in now, I can't start an album unless I'm confident that I can make it better than the last one. If you think that your best work is already behind you, then you might as well not bother. I'd rather give up than think that I've already done my best album. My best album has not yet been made. My best album is always the next album. Otherwise, there's no point otherwise. I couldn't make an album if I didn't believe it was going to be better than the last one. If you collaborate with great musicians and great, you know, writers, it forces you to raise your game, because you're then looking at yourself and thinking, okay, well, what do I bring to the table here?
Yeah. And then like so I was thinking maybe you said it's a bit Boys to Men.
Vocalists like Elliot Cole, Wax and Herbal Tea, Joss Stone, Julia Ashby, Nick Corbin, Emma Noble, Ed Martin, those guys, you know, they force you to produce your best work. You know, you can't bring anything less than your A-game when you work with guys like that. It makes you make better music, simple as that. You know, those are the vocalists, but then there's the musician element as well and the writer element. So I work with, you know, great musicians, guys like George Cooper, who's a monster keys player, great writer as well. You know, Steve Down, a guitar player, who's amazing. Rory Simmons, trumpet player, horn arranger. Harry Harding, who's a great drummer, multi-instrumentalist. Lucas Drinkwater, great writer, bass player, guitar player. You know, these guys are you know, they forced me to look at myself and raise my game and make better music ultimately. That's what we're there for, just to make better music. From a musician point of view, I'm lucky enough I can play a few instruments, but none to a level that these guys can play at. My thing is, you know, the big picture and putting it all together and moulding it and shaping it into how I think a record should be made. That's what I bring to the table.